What's up, YouTube, and welcome back to Kang Bros TV. We have got a different setup this time round due to some COVID isolating flex going on at the moment. So we apologize, but hope this will make up for the videos that we missed. So we're going to do a quick recap over the Tottenham game and the Palace game. So the last week has been fantastic for Liverpool. We're now, 5-6 points sitting on top of the league, and it's been some great results and some good performances as well. So let's kick off first with Tottenham. The first half of Liverpool in that game was just incredible.
The best team lost, though.
Don't forget that, bro. The best team lost.
At any point that we talk about now, the best team lost. Yeah, remember that.
I'm glad you mentioned that, bro. Listen, you know Mourinho, yeah? I try my hardest to like the guy. I generally do, because he has achieved a lot in the game.
He's a dom. Want to like him because he's a dom.
Exactly. And even when he was a pundit, for a short space of time, he gave the props when needed, right? But then he goes and does that interview and says what he does at the best team loss. And I'm just like, what are you talking about, bro? And he just says dumb shit. I think even after his defeat against Leicester, he's still saying shit like, we shouldn't have lost that game. I don't know, man. He says shit just to wind people up for me. That's what it is.
That's all it is. When everyone, if you listen to all the pundits, they're always like, oh, that's when he's at his best, when he can say things that winds people up. But for me, if I'm a Spurs fan, I'd be sitting there thinking to myself, I don't know if I can believe that. I don't know if I can believe what you're
telling
me. They're
not,
though. Because I don't believe it.
They're not. I've seen it all over Twitter. I've seen people commenting on some of our posts that we did on Instagram, saying, "Yeah, we had genuine chances. We could have won that game." I'm like, but that's all ifs, buts, and maybes.
How many times are you going to say that when you come to Anfield, or even when you've played against Liverpool? Was it last season when they had a chance at the back post when Son was 1-on-1 and he put it over? A couple of years before that, they had a few chances, but the format of the game is football. You will get chances. Is that all you're going to live off? Oh, I'll tell you what, if we had done this in the Champions League final, we could have won it. Or if we didn't do this, we could have won that game. But you didn't. The fact of the matter is, this is what happened. You got a team that had a lot more chances. If you're going to sit out for your whole game plan is to sit out for those two chances that you didn't take, and you want to blame Bergwijn and you want to hammer him over social media because he missed those chances, then let's have the same energy for the other way then. Because you've got to turn around and say, well, Liverpool had carved out a lot of chances, had a lot of possession. We were camped in our own half and they had chances to score and they didn't go in. So if that's the energy you want to take, then everyone could say the same thing. Sometimes you just got to sit up and say, yeah, we were beaten today because we didn't take our chances, and that's not the level we need to be at. Yes, we were under the cosh, but we had a game plan and whatever. But just a bit of, I don't know, man. If Spurs fans genuinely believe that they were the better team and they lost the game, then there's a reason why everyone says that you are Spursy. You do a Spursy thing, because there's no level of understanding then. That's obviously why you are as fans as you are, maybe, because there's no level of understanding of what is actually good and what is shit.
Like, before we was going to do this reaction video to the game, I was actually going to have a different approach to it completely. I was actually going to say, I want to give praise to Tottenham, because they did... You know, even in the first half, they rode the storm, whatnot, and they did cut out those chances. I was actually going to give them respect to say, listen, if they did take those chances, they could have won the game, and it was good to see them. They're still in the game. They had some really good chances. But when he went on to say that and just totally disrespected the whole thing, as I said, the game is of two halves. And just like you said, so I would have said first half Liverpool were, well, I was going to say first half Liverpool were great. Second half Tottenham had some big chances in that game, which could have turned the game on its head, but they didn't do it, whatnot, right? But that's what I'm saying. For him to come out and just say that the best team lost was just nonsense, because then he just totally disregarded the whole first half, the whole possession stats, all the stats you want to look at, wherever you want, Liverpool were beating them. So this is why, for me, like, I just found it annoying. So I was like, you know what, Mourinho, fuck you, because you continue to be a dick. And that's a problem. Like, even though I really, really want to say, you know what, Mourinho tactics do work sometimes and all this kind of stuff, but I just can't, because
even then, if you look at... the game that obviously the weekend just gone, you've just got beaten, like you say, you've still got stuff to say, and it's like, mate, a team has come to your house. The fact of the matter is, now in the last two games that you've played, one of them is a champion, one of them is someone that's in and around you in the league,
and you've lost.
You've not scored a goal. You scored a goal in both those games, so you've not got clean sheets in those games, and you've lost both of those games without scoring. Now,
Son scored, didn't he? So, but yeah.
sorry, okay, my bad, they scored. But you've not won the games. You haven't won those games. You haven't taken a point from those games. So the fact of the matter is, out of a potential 6 points against teams that are in and around you in the league that you claim you're better than, you haven't taken a point from.
Yeah, and he's gonna distract the whole focus on that to away from we didn't deserve to lose those games.
Yeah, it's fine. Well, if you didn't deserve to lose them, fine, but you've lost them. You've lost those games. Mm-hmm. So I'm sorry, that doesn't run with me too tough, because we've been there as Liverpool fans. We've played really well. We felt we've played well in games and we've lost. But the fact of the matter is, we have to sit there and say, yes, okay, we may have huffed and puffed, but we didn't win. And that's what you're there for, to stack points and put them on the board. Man United are playing dead, but they're winning. They're winning games. Do you know what I mean?
As I said, on the performances. Now, for me, Curtis Jones, we always talk about Curtis Jones, how we want him to prove us wrong. Like, we believe that he won't reach the heights that people are saying he will. But this game was the best I've seen Curtis Jones in Liverpool shirt. And I've said this to a lot of people, which is that we want to be proven wrong. And, you know, a lot of people say he's a baller, whatnot. This game here, he proved, not proved, but he showed that this was, he can mix it at this level, and that this was definitely his best performance in Liverpool shirt. Now, the only thing I would say on top of that is that people, once again, obviously went a bit too far ahead. I start seeing shit on Twitter again about, we've got the next Steven Gerrard. The Gerrard is born. Rare, rare, rare. Now, Curtis Jones was amazing, but so...
Let him live, yeah? Let him breathe.
But so was everybody else. If you look in the first half, you tell me who really put a foot wrong. Fabinho is ridiculous. Fabinho is ridiculous, bro. To come in... People seem to forget that this guy is not a centre-back. He's just coming in here and just doing... Hitting heights just were ridiculous. His defensive work was amazing, and that's what I want to say. Like, some of the performances in that first half and against Tottenham, there were so many good performances across the board from Liverpool. So yes, but for me, Curtis Jones, like I said, you need to give him props when it's due. That was his best
100%
in a Liverpool shirt.
100%. So like I said, with Curtis Jones, I've been a harsh critic. I know I have, but that's just my honest opinion on things. That game, I was like, yeah, you know what? He's coming to the party. That's a good performance. But on the flip side, I'm not now all of a sudden turning around and saying he's the next best thing. I'm not saying that, but he's had a good game. And that, if that's the level you're going to hit consistently, then fair play to you. Yeah. But from the other fans, you're too far the other way. Listen, don't ruin a kid's career before it's even begun. You know, listen, let's not put him in that bracket of calling him a Steven Gerrard. Steven Gerrard is one of the greatest players to have graced the Premier League. Just leave it at that, you know. Zidane saying that, you know, speaks of him in a certain breath. Listen, I hope he does hit those levels, but let him hit those levels. Don't propel him up so high and drop him. You've seen it happen with other players in the past, you know. So let's one step at a time.
You know what I really like though is, like, you know, we talk about what is his role in the team. It's even though that Tottenham set up all these banks of defenders and all playing very negative as they always do, it's the way they were breaking through those lines with ease, and it was because the likes of Curtis Jones doing those quick 1-2s, a little pass around the corner, and he was having the confidence and the audacity to do that.
He wants the ball. Yeah, he wants
exactly
the ball.
And that's what I've said. Yeah. He's so ballsy for his age. It's ridiculous.
Ballsy, yeah.
And so hopefully it continues. So that was a great performance from Curtis Jones. And then the man like Bobby. Yeah, the Bobby haters. You saw Instagram popping off from Kangaroos TV, me and just sending shit for Firmino. We tried to extend as much as we could to say, you know, the whole doubt around Bobby. That fans way back, people who are following us, they know who they are. I added them on the picture. They were saying, "Oh, get rid of Bobby. Bobby's this, Bobby's that." And we was like, we scratching heads, still trying to delay as much as possible. We weren't trying to give up on Bobby, and he does this. His performance was great and the goal was bad. And then now, if you look at his confidence going into the Palace game, he was levels. So this is what I'm saying. Don't ever doubt Bobby Firmino, bro. That's what I've learned.
So for me, I think that's a good point to talk up to bridge it into the next game is Firmino, because that game against Spurs, that header was, and you can see how much it meant to him as well. As much as everybody else, they all go running to him because everyone loves him. Because they appreciate what he does for that team. That brings us nicely onto the next game. And the goals that he scored, the setup, the assist, the pass that... Mane's goal was mad, but the pass, the reverse pass into the tight space, yes, the touch and finish was ridiculous, but that's what he brings in. If he can add a couple of goals, which he's doing now, which he has done of late, people start realizing, actually, do you know what? Yeah, you start thinking to yourself, do you know what? Yeah, I was foolish for saying anything like that. I'm foolish because he's a class. He's class. He, that player, that front three are world class. They're a world class front three. Firmino gets in for me because the top teams, even but like a Barcelona, yes, he doesn't score as many goals, but for me, everyone talks about your Barca's, Madrid's, and all that stuff. For me, Firmino gets into any team at the moment. Top teams in the Champions League, he gets into, just like the other front three. They will get into the teams out there. There's no team out there at the moment that I look at and think they wouldn't be better off without Firmino.
The Bobby haters now have gone quiet. Now the people saying, "Oh, he needs to be consistent here and then this." Look, if you're just looking at goals, you're missing everything. You're missing the whole picture.
You're missing the point. Yeah.
You're missing everything.
Like I said, we've said this as well. Like, there's been times when he said poor games, and we've highlighted. I said, "Listen, yo, Bobby needs to get back to what he." Yeah. And that was because it was the headers, the little tackles that he used to do, exactly. the connecting exactly. the plays, and he wasn't even at one page. He was misplacing passes, which is something that we've never seen him do before as regularly. But nowadays, okay, it's like, yeah, he's tidying things up, and the goals, yeah, a bit more confidence, but. As a football, like I said, people that don't like Bobby Firmino, he's an easy target because you can tell he's quite a humble guy and in the way he plays his football and whatnot. But I was really, really happy for him over these last couple of weeks because he deserves that. He deserves just a little bit of flipping respite.
Yeah. And the thing is, right, going into over Christmas, being at the top of the league, whatnot, and then I see, obviously, you see Ox coming back on the pitch. Right, and Thiago's not even in the mix yet. You got Jota who's injured, who needs to come back into it. It's just this team and the squad that is together when it can, you know, just sprinkling that Thiago on top of this now, going into the
Minamino scores.
Oh yeah, I forgot to mention Minamino. He took that goal Minamino sick.
His first goal.
That really goal was well. Actually sick.
I'm not going to turn around and completely flip my script now because I did say I was always the one that said, listen, give him time because I do see a player in there. But the reason I've always said that is because. The way he takes the ball in tight areas, that takes balls to do that. And that finish is ballsy. For someone who hasn't scored a goal yet, that's a ballsy finish. So fair play to him for doing that. But there's times in that game when he gave the ball away because he was still that lightweight. So you do look at it and think there's still room. But I was really happy with the way Naby played the other day. Yes, there was little bits in there with rust, but he linked up play really well. In most of the goals, he had something to do with it at some point. So I was really impressed with him. He seems to go under the radar, coming back into the side. Millie, Shaqiri aren't far away apparently, then that means that we're 10 days away from potentially seeing Thiago in and around things now on a full-time basis. I still think we could do the defender because we're asking a lot from young lads and stuff. Fabinho, I just want to say, I know we mentioned it at the Spurs game, but there's one point the other day when they had a chance when they got in and I thought, if they square this now, they're going to score an "Oh, you played a bad pass." That was the one thing I can think at. And maybe the Swansea game when he gave away that potential foul on the edge of the box when they got the penalty. But Zaha tried to run in the other day, yeah? Not the ball and run past Fabinho. Fabinho threw out the shoulder, yeah? Like he'd been doing military press before the game. Get off me, bro. And sent him far. And even Zaha just went, yeah, fair play. Do you know what I mean? And I'm looking at that thinking, that's a centre-back. That's a part-time centre-back. He's a right-back who's played, he's a midfielder. He's a midfielder that's been right-back, but you know, and then he's gone into centre-back. And not only is he going to centre back, he's now arguably the person that everyone wants to see next to Van Dijk. Do you know what I mean?
Mate, there was a time in the Crystal Palace game, there's a cross came in. I don't remember it. There's a cross that came in and there was a player running in the back sticks behind him. If he hadn't touched that ball, he knew the maze behind
him. Tompkins, I think, wasn't it?
Yeah, and he literally passed it out to a corner. And I was like, it's just mad that the fact that we... Yeah. The level he's hitting and just taking in, we don't even realise right now that Van Dijk is missing. We just miss his presence and stuff, right? But the fact that the job that even Matip is doing as well, like you said,
he's brilliant.
He doesn't get praised enough. He just doesn't get praised enough because... But
like I said, for me, with the injury situation and the way that they've managed and juggled things, I think we do need some form of cover in there, just like a proper centre-off, because even when they're all fit, I still think we were quite light in that area. So if they can go get a big centre back now, I think that would be a statement. Whether or not they will or not, I don't know. The manager could put up the board might turn around and be like, "You're top of the league at Christmas. Shut your mouth and carry on." And they'll be well within their rights because it's their money. But it's like for me, I wouldn't mind seeing that cover. I thought the other day, Mane, I didn't like his. I'll be honest, I didn't like the reaction when he got subbed. I wasn't a fan of it. Because I understand people are vexed when they come off. I understand it. I know you've done all the hard work and now Salah comes on and gets two goals and you're going to be there like, that's my goals. I could have had a hat-trick or whatever. But that's happened to Matey before as well. So let's just remember, like, you know, come on, let's just take a deep breath here. Don't make a fool of yourself, because you do look, it looks childish, doesn't it?
Yeah, I don't really agree. Yeah, I don't really agree with the whole commentators and all this, because they always say, oh yeah, it's great to see your strikers come off angry and all this kind of stuff, because it shows that the hunger's there and all this. I'm like, well, where's the fucking respect? Do you know what I mean?
If I was a teammate, I'd be like, mate, stop being a dick. That's what I literally thinking. Stop being a dick, mate.
Yeah, like, that's what I'm saying. I don't actually buzz off it. Like, Bobby Firmino, like, I know his personality is completely different. He scored 2 goals, walked off smiling, sat on the bench, and he's buzzing. And I've never seen him actually huff and puff and come off. He's been taken off a number of times before these guys, and he just comes off and does his thing. So, like, for me, there's a level of respect, and also there's a level of, you know why Klopp is doing it. You 100% know why he's doing it. So, and there was talks about the reason why he was actually angry wasn't because he was coming off, because he was promised a certain time that he was meant to come off and all this kind of stuff. But it doesn't matter. For me, it's just like, show some respect. And I don't know. I don't really like
it. And it's almost like, I don't buzz off it and whatever. I see the point. I can see why there's a frustration, but I don't like the way that it was dealt with. Because in my mind, I'm thinking, as a teammate, I'd be thinking, that's shit. Mate. That's shit, that. That's what I'd be thinking. But at the same time, I thought, when Salah came on, like, that second goal when he stuck in the top bins, the amount of times, you know, we've seen that and it goes into the flipping in row Z and we're just like, what a little... Do you know what I mean? But then he does that, sits in the top bins, and then you're like, and everyone's buzzing. So it's frustrating. But like yesterday, it felt a bit like how when we played against Villa, everything they did just went in. Do you remember? And it was, you sit there and you think, that's not going to happen again, is it? Them goals ain't happening again. And I feel that that's probably where Palace are going to be like, you know what, take the L. That's everything that they've touched is literally turned to gold, and everything that Palace had touched didn't. And our goal difference all of a sudden is flipped on its head now. The goals, you know, we were the -5 that we copped at Villa, we've made up for that, and now, and +2, which is the 2 goals, you could say, right, they beat Palace 2-0. So it kind of cancels that out to a certain extent with the big win against Wolves and stuff like that. So much healthier place. The performance first half I thought was a bit iffy against Palace. They started the game really well. Palace really got into it. Second half, we just battered them. We battered them second half. And I think they'd almost given up, and they were like, look, let's just not cop too many. And they still took 7. So,
yeah, I think Roy Hodgson's reaction kind of said it all, really. Like, he literally sat down and thought, fucking hell. Which literally that when Salah's went in. And so, I mean, like I said, it's a great week or so for Liverpool going into Christmas on top of the league. We've got West Brom, Newcastle, Southampton next, and then the fourth game after that is Man United. So those three games, it's pretty good, I would say. Going in of a Christmas period, normally we have some dirty fixtures in there. So other teams I know have got some dirty fixtures in there. So hopefully we can capitalise on that. And there's rumours of, as you said, Thiago being back for maybe the West Brom game on the 27th. So things are looking good, all in all. So you know, but as I said, the question I want to ask people is the whole Mourinho thing. If you want to add anything on to that, because I know it's been talked about a lot, but you know,
are we wrong on that? And I'd love to hear from people. Are we seeing it with Liverpool blinkers on? And did the best team lose? Is that the general consensus from other people? And I'd love to know, from Spurs fans or anyone from other clubs who watch that, do you enjoy watching Tottenham play like that? Is it any form of satisfaction? Because the way I see it, when the fans come back. And I know it's been pushed back a little bit because we've got new tiers that are made now all of a sudden. But when the fans come back, I'm not sure they're going to be happy seeing that level, that style of football at home against Leicester to get beat 2-0 when they probably should have been 3. I'm not sure I'm not sure that's going to go down great. And I don't think they're going to like the fact that they've gone to Liverpool, sat up how they have, and got beat. Yes, it was a performance that people could say they can be proud of it because they were in the game. But I'm not sure fans are gonna buzz off that for too long. That's just my personal opinion. So I'd love to hear what people's thoughts are on that. And from the Palace game perspective, I would love to hear what people think. I mean, is that just something that was due from us, or was it just a one-off, or is that something that the level that we should be hitting? Like, not necessarily 7, but you know, is that the level of performance and finishing that we should you know, expect as the norm?
My point on what you mentioned there, I think Spurs fans, I think they just care about where they are in the league. They've been deemed so shit for so many years, and that's with disrespect, but the fact that they're in the mix of being near the top of the league, I think they will just take it. So for me,
would they
different clubs would want a different standard.
Would their cup run be more important to them? That's my. That's what I'd say to you. That with the cup games coming up, is that more important to them?
Mate, Mourinho, you know what he's like. If he can get his hold on any type of trophy, he will then big that up to the heels like he did with the United. So that's what he would do. So he would guarantee.
We said this when he first took the job. You're selling your soul, but you'll get
trophies,
almost silverware. Yeah. Whatever trophy it will be, but you're selling your soul, and that's exactly what's proven to be happening. So it would be interesting.
So let us know your take on these on the reviews of these two games. So until then, we'll see you in the next one, which will be against West Brom on the 27th. Everybody have a good Christmas, and we'll see.
Stay safe.
Yeah, stay safe, and we'll see you back here after Christmas. So
probably see you in tier 10, by the sounds of
it. Tier 26. But yeah, don't forget to share, like, subscribe, and definitely comment. Peace.